Open your Bibles with me to the book of 1 John. We are this year in a theme called what?
Becoming disciples.
Becoming disciples. And so we have our discipleship class on Wednesday nights. Still not too late if you want to participate in that. Got a good group coming. And the messages that we are going to be bringing this year is going to be dealing with discipleship. And one of the things that I wanted to do is I wanted to find a book that talked about discipleship that we could learn from and get some, you know, lessons from, and that would help us grow together and grow closer to Christ, grow spiritually. And of course, the answer to that question is from Genesis and Revelation. Will help us do that if we read and study. But I wanted to look for something specific. And the two books that came to mind is the book of James and the book of 1 John. And you know, the book of 1 John, I want to say something about it. It is very deceptive. I remember when I started the Spanish congregation 7 or 8 years ago, we were meeting at the North Long Beach Christian Church, and we were meeting upstairs, and I decided to go through the book of 1 John. And you know, the book of John is a great book for bringing people to Christ and introducing them to Christ and bringing them in. But 1 John is a little deep. And I have to be honest with you, that was the first time that I thought through it. And after about the second chapter, I was like, what did I get myself into? Because it is very deep, and I'm going to start you off with something. There are 4 or 5 verses in this book that I don't understand. So if you're coming, listening to me, thinking that you're going to get all the answers to everything, look again, because I don't have them. But those verses, I've been listening to people like J. Vernon McGee and Chuck Swindoll and others, and I'm in good company because they confess they don't understand them either, so we're good. But this book has a lot that it can offer to us in our walk and our relationship with Christ and our relationship to each other. So with that, I want to kind of today go through an introduction of this book. But I want to start reading chapter 1 and verse 1. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked at and our hands have touched, this we proclaim concerning the word of life. The life appeared, we have seen it and testified to it, and we proclaim to you the eternal life, which was with the Father and has appeared to us. We proclaim to you that what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us, and our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We write this to make our joy complete. John was one of the inner circle of Jesus. He was the disciple that the Bible says that Jesus loved. I've never quite understood that, because I think Jesus loved all of his disciples and all of us as disciples equally well. But there was a special bond and a special relationship that Jesus had with his inner circle, and it seemed like particularly with John. And John wrote 5 books in the Bible. And one of the interesting things about them that I didn't realize until I was putting this together, I was looking at this, and all 5 books that he wrote at the end of his life, at the end of the first century, and he was probably in his 80s when he wrote all 3 of these books. He wrote the book of John, which is probably the most famous New Testament book, and the book of John is wonderful, as I've already said, to introduce people to Jesus, to bring people into the church. The book of John is specifically written to to draw people, to speak to people's heart as to who Jesus Christ is. It is one of the four Gospels, but it's written from a little different slant, and it's kind of written more from a heart perspective. Then you have the book of Revelation. The book of Revelation, John wrote while he was on the Isle of Patmos. And he wrote it while he was in exile in jail. They were trying to shut him up, and they put him on this island, and that's when God revealed to him, and he wrote the book of Revelation. But then sometime after that, you have John writing these three letters. And the letter is not addressed to anyone in particular. I think that it is because it is kind of the last book of the New Testament that was written. Now, the book of Revelation, I need to clarify something. The book of Revelation was written after that, but this is the first letter that we have to the churches. And I think that God intentionally wanted to keep it open because of the content in this book. Because you see, John was written to bring people in. First John was written, okay, now what do you do with that faith? What do we do with that faith that we have placed in Jesus Christ? It is a very practical handbook of theology, a very practical handbook of how we should live, and it also addresses a lot of what Christians do not like to talk about, a lot of moral issues. And so John wrote this book, and he says, that which was from the beginning. And when you look at that, you obviously can put that and compare that back to what verse? John 1:1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And so he's introducing us to what he's going to develop later. And so I don't want to get into it a whole lot here, but he's introducing us to the theological content of God's Word. And there's something that I've shared with you before, but I want to lay it out right here from the beginning of this message, because I'm going to come back to it, because I think it is one of the most important concepts that we understand as a church today in the city of Long Beach. John here is laying out, and as he's going to do through this book, what we call absolutes. And people today do not like absolutes. Let me go another step further and be more specific. Churches today, particularly in the city of Long Beach, a whole lot of them do not like absolutes. And you can talk to, as I have, I know they exist everywhere, but I have never come across it like I have since I came to Long Beach, of all of these churches and pastors and leaders who are operating more on philosophy and more of what's relevant to what they think to them in the community. And they are absolutely throwing in the towel on Christian absolutes. And I'm telling you, we have to be rooted and grounded in the absolutes of the faith. And they do exist, no matter what television preacher is telling you otherwise. So when we come to specific doctrines within the church, there are different levels. You remember me sharing this with you. There's the first level, which is Christian absolute. They are things like God is. God created the heavens and the earth. God exists in three forms: Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and the three are one. That Jesus Christ stepped down out of heaven and took on the form of a man. And he lived 3 years and ministered and taught. And then he died on a cross, and 3 days later he rose from the dead with all power in his hands. And then 40 days later, he ascended into, 50 days later, he ascended into heaven. And he is now sitting at the right hand of the Father, interceding for you and me. That is an absolute. The fact that Jesus Christ is not a way, but the only way for any man or woman to have and inherit salvation. The fact that this word is God's truth, His word, His love letter written to us. It is God's word. It is infallible. The power of the Holy Spirit moving through the land today, drawing men and women to Himself. These are all Christian absolutes. And as Christians, we cannot move that a little bit to the right or to the left of the central truth that God has given to us, and we need to stand up and defend them wherever we go.
Amen.
But the problem we have is that's just the first level. There's a whole lot of, a couple of levels underneath that, and there's a whole lot of truths at the second level that are vital and are very important, but we're not going to break fellowship over them. But people have taken and moved it up to the first level. Let me give you a great example. The doctrine of the baptism of the Holy Spirit and speaking in tongues. There are churches around us who believe you have to speak in tongues, and if you don't, you don't know Jesus. There are churches around us who teach if you speak in tongues or even think that speaking in tongues is for today, it's straight to hell. Do not pass go, do not collect $200, straight to hell for speaking in tongues. Guess what? We have people here who are on both sides of the fence. Why? How can that happen? How can that occur? Because speaking in tongues or not speaking in tongues is a secondary issue. What matters is, what have you done with Jesus?
Yes. Amen.
And if we have Jesus where He's supposed to be, no matter where you are on this issue, everything else will work itself out.
Amen. Amen.
But when we try to elevate a secondary doctrine into a primary one, all we do is cause division and doubt and confusion and dissension within the body of Christ. But then it gets even worse. Because then you have these issues that churches fight about that do not matter. But we have people who take issues with things that do not have any relevance or importance to Jesus Christ at all. Beautiful worship hymn. I know a church in Michigan who split twice over hymnals. I'm serious. Because in the front, it was an official Southern Baptist hymnal. But on the front, they put Church of God, Anderson, Indiana on it. And then after they worked that out, one group wanted blue and the other one wanted green hymnals. Fighting over things that do not matter. Women preachers.
Well.
You can have your opinion on it. I have my opinion on it. But guess what? It's not my responsibility. I didn't call them. I'm not going to uncall them. It's God's problem. Let Him deal with it. And if God uses women to save people, glory, praise God. And if He takes His hand off from them, well, that's His business. It's not mine. And there are churches that will split and divide over these issues that do not matter. We need to move our focus from this foolishness and get it on these primary issues and preach Jesus and Him crucified and let Him work the rest of it out. John here is telling these people, look, here we are. We have seen Jesus with our own eyes. We have heard him with our own ears. We have touched him with our own hands. He's telling these people, and he's not going to do it once, but he does it like three times in these first four verses. Why? Because in this time period, within 40, 50 years after Jesus' resurrection, something interesting has happened to the church. And we have to be careful and listen to the application of this and apply it to us. Because if it was relevant then, it's definitely relevant for us today. Because what happens, and there are first and second century church fathers who have written on this stuff, is the people within the churches who were fired up for God, who were serving God, who were giving their lives for Christ, have all of a sudden gotten used to and accustomed to their faith. It no longer stirred them up like it used to. Now they had other things going on. Jesus is coming back. They've been saying that for 20 years now. He still hasn't come back. And so people began to become apathetic, lethargic, lazy about their faith. They began to embrace other things, traditionalism, mysticism, Gnosticism. All of these things began to infiltrate the church. And Paul is here is probably specifically addressing Gnosticism. Excuse me, John. And we're going to talk about this a little more, but it's important that we understand that he says, hey, look, our Lord is here, I touched her. Jesus is here, I touched him. Our Lord was here, I heard her with my own ears sing tonight. I saw her with my own eyes. Why? Because there are people who were proclaiming and saying, Jesus didn't come in the flesh. And he says this truth, and this is where I want to go with this point, this truth that Jesus Christ did come, he did die, he did come in the flesh, and we saw it, we heard it, this truth is what we proclaim to you. Why? Because the people had gotten passive, they have gotten content, they have gotten lazy, and now there's no need to tell others. When was the last time you shared the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ with somebody else? I'm not talking about your church. I'm talking about Jesus. When was the last time you shared your faith in Jesus with somebody else?
Last night.
And the next question, why has it been so long? And so John is saying we proclaim, and there are too many people who use the excuse, well, I just live the gospel. I had an aunt who was a white witch. And she had a neighbor who was an older gentleman. And she would talk about this guy, and she would say, he is just an incredible man. He's a wonderful man. And the thing I like about him is he's a leader in his church, and he never, ever bothers us with his church or with the gospel at all. Mm-hmm. A few years later, she got saved. And she said, I don't understand why my neighbor, who was a leader in a church, never took the time to share these truths with me. because we think that our lifestyle is all that it takes. No, we need to open our mouths and we need to talk to people that Jesus saves. Now, why did Paul write this? And there are four reasons that, John, that John wrote this. And I want to take some time and look at these four reasons. The first one we find is in verse 4. The first thing that we see is we write this to make our joy complete, or your joy complete. So as I was studying this out, I come to find out that when we read that, as it is there, it just means like, you know, Tina, I just hope that you're just full of joy today and all the joy you want is in you. But that's not what it's saying. What it's saying is that at one time when I had an encounter, an experience with Jesus Christ, something in me came alive. It changed. It transformed. And yes, I became a radical and a fanatic for Jesus because of the burning fire that I had within me. I just couldn't keep it contained, the joy that I had. But now, I've kind of gotten used to it. The fire has burned out. That I'm just trying to make it through another day. And what this is saying is that joy that you started with will continue through your whole life until the day that Jesus calls you home, that you will never get burnt out, you will never get tired of it, you will always have and experience that original joy that you had. Let's look at another place where John talks about this. Let's go to the book of Revelation chapter 2. Revelation chapter 2 and verse 4. Yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken the love you had at first. Consider how far you have fallen. And then later he says a very profound word. Repent! Why? Because he wants us to return. He's telling us, this is the first church in Ephesus. This is where John was one of the elders of this church. And he's saying, you guys have become cold. You've become hardened towards the things of the gospel. Repent and return. Revelation chapter 3. There are many people who study Bible prophecies and study the book of Revelation who says that these churches represent different ages we live in, and that the church of Laodicea is the last age, and they believe this is the age that we are living in. Look at what Jesus has to say to this church. To the angel of the church in Laodicea writes, and most people feel that angel is just a messenger, so that would be the pastor. These are the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the ruler of God's creation. Who is that? Jesus. I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were either one or the other. So because you are lukewarm, neither hot or cold, I am about to spit you out of my mouth. What does that mean? God is saying, I died for you. I gave my life for you. I came into your heart and life and you experienced new life. You experienced this joy. And now you have walked away from it. And because of that, I am ready to walk away from you. God wants us, and part of the reason why he wrote this is because he wants us to waken up, to liven up, and become radicals for Jesus again. The second one is in 1 John chapter 2. My dear children, I write this to you. I'm writing this book to you. I'm writing this letter to you so that you will not sin. One of the problems that we have as individual Christians and oftentimes as a whole body of Christ is we embrace the sin. One of the things that Paul is writing, John is writing to here, is he is writing and addressing Gnosticism. Gnosticism had two central tenets of their faith. One, flesh is evil. And two, that what we need to have, what we need to develop and encounter is this mystical, revelational, high up kind of faith. That we need to have this intellectual standard that's up and above, higher than everyone else's. And that's how we're saved. Now, with that came a couple of problems. Number one is false doctrine, because if the flesh is evil, how could God incarnate flesh? So therefore, that Christ never, never was God. But the other part of that is, because the flesh is evil, they began to abuse the flesh, trying to subdue it into subjection. And they would hate themselves. They would hate other people around them that were tempting them. And so they would push all of that evil away, and they would begin to cut themselves off from. I know some of you have seen in some movies and stuff where you'll have priests or different people, they'll be beating themselves with whips and all that. All of that comes from the central thing of Gnosticism, that the flesh is innately evil. But it also had another part. If the flesh is evil, then it's worthless. It doesn't mean anything. The flesh is not valid. So therefore, go ahead and live and do whatever the flesh you want to do, because the flesh is evil. If you want to pump drugs into your veins, pump it. You want to flush alcohol down your system, drink it. You want to go out and have all kinds of sexual encounters, and just go ahead and do it. Why? Because the flesh is evil, and the whole goal is to destroy the flesh anyways. Because only the spirit is what matters. So what has happened is, in these churches, these people have developed this mentality and said, if it feels good, just do it. Go ahead and sin. Don't worry about it. Because the flesh is just going to die anyways. And so the people were putting it in practice. And John is saying, no, 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 no. Part of the reason why I've written this is because the flesh isn't evil. When God created Adam, after he was done, what did he say? It is good. The flesh is not evil. The sin in the flesh is. But the flesh is not evil. And he's saying, stop using this argument to keep on sinning. Church, listen to me. Everybody's doing it is not a valid excuse. Other churches are practicing it is not a valid excuse. God says, stay clear of sin. But since we're here, I might as well talk about another subject. The next thing says, but if you do sin, why? Because he knows us. Let me rephrase that. He knows me. Pastor, you've got sin? Yep. Lots of them. And if you knew my sin, you wouldn't be sitting here listening to me tonight. Don't look too smug. If I knew yours, I wouldn't be preaching to you. But he says, if you do sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ.
Amen. Thank you, God.
Why? Because he knew we would. So the third reason we have is verse 26 of chapter 2. I am writing these things to you about those who are trying to lead you astray. John, 1 John 5:13. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may hope that you have eternal life. Is that what it says?
No.
You may know.
I write these things to you so that you may earn your way to eternal life.
No.
No.
I write these things to you so that you can know 100% absolutely, positively, without any doubt, when this flesh passes away, I am going to be with Jesus. And it's sad how many people spend years in churches and do not know. When we started a church in New York City, at that time, knocking on doors and talking to people was relevant, and we spent 8-10 hours a day doing that. And there's this particular church there that kind of dominated New York City. And almost every door we knocked on, when we talked about this, the response was, you cannot know. You will not know until you stand before St. Peter. First of all, I'm going to stand before God, not St. Peter. But it's completely contradictory to what this says. It says tonight, before you leave this place, you can know that you have eternal life. Why? Because God's Spirit, when we accept Him, comes in. And He bears witness with my spirit that I am a child of God. And He does the same thing, or will do the same thing, for you. John does not want his readers to have any questions or doubts. I read a little bit of it in the previous verse where it says you don't need anyone to teach. Why? Because the Holy Spirit is in you. That's why you can come and listen to me preach every week for the next 20 years and go to heaven, and God can say, you're wrong. You're not getting in. And you say, well, it's my fault. I listened to Pastor Ted. And He's going to say, but you have the Holy Spirit. and God's word, you're without excuse. Because this and God's spirit is what matters. Let's go back to chapter 1, and I'm going to finish with this. We proclaim to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us, and our fellowship is with the Father and His Son, Jesus Christ. The last thing I just want to mention tonight is fellowship. Fellowship. One of the problems that's greatest in churches today, and I'm sure it's existed throughout history, is church division, church fighting, church friction, church problems. And then after we're all here, we get up and we march out this door and go next door to fellowship. And we have this clique over here that talks about this clique over here, who talks about the clique up here, who wants to know what is these people doing here with us, all in the name of fellowship. Let me say something as an introduction to fellowship, and then I'll be done. Fellowship is true, open relationship in unity with those that are around us in the body of Christ. But before we can have that fellowship, that unity, that open relationship, we have to have a correct, right relationship with our Father and have fellowship with Him. Because it's only through that fellowship with Him that I can overlook the faults and the problems of this group over here, and the faults and the problems of the group over here, and the faults and the problems of the group over here. Why? Because the Bible says love covers a multitude of sins.
Amen.
But here's the good news. When my fellowship is right here, I'm covered with the blood of Jesus Christ, and all He sees is that blood, and He doesn't see the mess that is me. And when I get that right, then I can get this right. And then I can get this right. And they can get that right. But none of that will happen until this is right. And here's something. The Bible says to examine yourself to see if you're in the faith. Here's something to examine yourself. If this is always a mess, there is probably something wrong with this. And don't even try to start fixing this. By the way, they don't have a mess going on, so I just got to say that. At least I know. I hope we'll talk after this. So, this, don't even try to fix until this is right, because you'll just create a bigger mess here. Fellowship. We're going to talk a lot about it. When I taught that Bible study years ago, let me share with you what happened. There were six men. It was like the third or fourth week. And for about the second or third time, John says, "How can you say that you love God who you cannot see, if you hate your brother that you cannot see? You need to forgive one another." That's a paraphrase. Guy raises his hand. He says, "Excuse me, Pastor. I don't think that's what it says." "Okay, well, I'm open. What does it say?" "Well, I don't know what it says, but it can't say that, because there are people that I hate, and I think God is okay with that, and I am not going to forgive them." And the guy sitting next to him says, "You know what? I agree with him." Remember when I started, we have these absolutes? This is God's word. What he says is absolute. So no matter how I feel, no matter how I think, no matter how difficult it may be, I still have to take the absolute and go and love my brother and even my sisters. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus Christ, and we pray that you would help make us disciples. Help us to become more like you. God, we thank you for writing this book, and we pray that as we go through it, you would speak to us, you would teach us, you would challenge and convict us. We pray these things in Jesus' name. And everybody said,
Amen.
Amen. Amen.